Like my predecessors, I thank the organization very much for inviting me, and I thank all you people for coming and listening. What I have to say is based on a chapter from our current book, and it covers decision-making in three countries, Austria-Hungary, Germany, and Russia. I don't think I'll be able to cover all of that, but we'll see how time allows and carry it as far as possible. In France, in Austria-Hungary, Germany, and Russia, the decision makers were the monarch, their appointed ministers, and several military leaders. In France and Britain, the key decision makers were elected leaders, prime ministers, cabinet members, some of their chosen colleagues, and members of the military. The dominance of dynastic and party coteries might suggest that other elites, such as industrial and financial leaders, were not involved in this decision-making. But some accounts claim that these decisions were taken for the benefit of business leaders, persons said to have been, in quotes, pulling the strings. A leading American textbook contains the following statement. Progressives and others tended to put the blame for the war on the greed of munitions manufacturers, stockbrokers, and bond dealers eager for wartime profits. Do you want to know the cause of the war? Henry Ford, who was no progressive, asked. It is capitalism, greed, and dirty hunger for dollars. Above all, progressives were sure the war would end reform. It consumed money and attention. It inflamed emotions. Another source, throughout 1915 and 1916, La Follette's magazine, the voice of the progressive leader, railed against the Morgans, Rockefellers, DuPonts, and the 38 corporations most benefited by war orders. Those brief paragraphs do not contain any serious evidence to support the notion of business dominance, the idea that political leaders were serving business interests. The use of the Ford quotation as it stands is ad hominem, suggesting that he had extensive contacts with other business leaders and was well informed as to their views. There is an easy alternative, and that is he did not know. He was an outsider, not welcome at all in the top business circles. His knowledge and judgment of public affairs was questionable. Ford made another statement which would challenge the one that he previously made, as that statement was that the Jews were the promulgators of the war. A biography of Woodrow Wilson, this by Arthur Link, contains an extensive account of the origins of the war, this specifying the position of the nation's business leaders with respect to European wars. It begins with a summary statement. Wars were mainly economic in causation and necessarily evil because bankers with money to lend, munitions makers with sordid profits to earn, and industrialists with markets to win were the chief promulgators and beneficiaries of war. Their preference stands in sharp contrast to that of their progressive opponents whose righteousness led straight to disarmament. Link's account does not name any of the business leaders, and not a single source is provided. Just a word on theoretical positions, the conflicting viewpoints. We have a serious problem here in that the two most likely theoretical options were classic liberalism, formulation dominant in the 19th century, and Marxist readings, those with considerable influence in the 20th century, and they provide diametric opposite conclusions. Liberal thinkers argued that international trade and economic interdependence provided powerful incentive for businessmen to oppose war. Among those taking those positions, we have Montesquieu, Adam Smith, Immanuel Kant, Thomas Paine, David Ricardo, Jeremy Bentham, James Mill, John Stuart Mill, Herbert Spencer, and several others. including Norman Angel, recipient of Nobel Peace Prize. Thomas Paine stated the basic problem as follows. If commerce were permitted to act to the universal extent it is capable, it would extirpate the system of war and produce a revolution in the uncivilized state of governments. John Stuart Mill, writing in 1848, declared that commerce is rapidly rendering war obsolete by strengthening and multiplying the personal interests which act in natural opposition to it. During the war, Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, in his Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism, argued that finance capital was responsible for the current development. You know all of that. He elaborated on that in several other statements. He said, the true class character of war was naturally not found in the diplomatic history of war, but rather in an analysis of the objective position of the ruling classes in all belligerent countries. A related account, one with considerable influence, was a stage play, George Bernard Shaw's 1905 stage play, Major Barbara. There, eminent businessman and arms manufacturer, Andrew Undershaft, scoffs at his son's naive conception of government, telling him that I am the government of your country. You will do what pays us. You will make war when it suits us. At the end of his declaration, Undershaft says he is now returning to my counting house to pay the piper and call the tune. Just a footnote on that, as this stage play appeared in a motion picture, which appeared in 1941. It'd be worthwhile investigating who was responsible for that production. My account reviews the attitudes of industrial and financial elites with respect to the prospect of war in 1914. As I've indicated, in two of the dynastic regime, Austria-Hungary and Germany, and also in an elected party government, Great Britain. The evidence has been culled from published literature on the subject, much of it appeared in rarely seen sources. My aim is to bring together those scattered materials so as to allow evidence-based conclusions. Two key questions. What were the attitudes of business leaders towards the possibility of war? Does the evidence show the governing coteries responding to or conforming to the demands put forward by the business leaders? The evidence reviewed allows assessment of both the liberal and the Leninist readings. Before proceeding to those cases, let me just take up the judgment of two prominent American capitalists, positions sharply opposed to the judgments of Henry Ford. In September 1914, John Pierpont Morgan, the head of the nation's leading international banking house, at that point he affirmed the liberal position, declaring that war would bring, quote, the most appalling destruction of values and securities which has ever been seen in this country. In the 1930s, Joseph Kennedy, one of the richest men in America, an entrepreneur and speculator in many fields. On serving as ambassador to Britain, he formed a close friendship with the Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain. The two men were said to have been of one mind in the necessity of avoiding the possibility of another war. Kennedy, quote, dreaded the economic and political consequences of war. A friend reported that Joe thought war was irrational and debasing. War destroyed capital. What could be worse than that? Another concern for Kennedy was familial. I have four boys, and I don't want them to be killed in foreign war. Let's turn to the case of Austria-Hungary. As I said, the war was made by a coterie consisting of the monarch, his ministers, and military leaders. The literature and the decision reports practically no direct involvement by business and financial leaders. We have some hard evidence attesting to the attitudes of investors generally. This includes businessmen, bankers, some wealthy aristocrats, and wealthy middle-class retirees. In the days immediately following the assassination of the Archduke, one author reports, the Vienna Bourse, the stock market, viewed the situation with some uneasiness, but without intense alarm. Traders, it is said, assumed the need for peace in the monarchy had increased, and what little change in government policy was expected. Stock prices accordingly dropped but little. But then, the calling of the meeting of the Council of Ministers on 7 July had a depressing effect on that market. Although the substance of the discussions was not known, the meeting itself resulted in a sharp fall in values, those reaching levels lower than had been known since the outbreak of the First Balkan War. The subsequent publication of the Note to Serbia, it is said, wrought havoc on the bourse. The nation's investors, in short, did not see war as serving their interests. We can take a look at a previous event. In 1912 and 1913, we have the Balkan Wars. They present something of a preview of the 1914 developments. They too had a depressing effect on most industries, disrupting trade within the area and discouraging investments. One sector, the arms industry, was doing very well at this time. Weapons manufacturing firms were scattered across the empire. Those firms were capital intensive, very profitable, and also unexpectedly perhaps very much export oriented. The leading firm of the city of Steyr, the major center of arms manufacture, a leading center of arms manufacture, received no orders from the Austrian-Hungary army in 1910 and had very limited sales in 1911 and 1912. But in the latter years, it had enormous sales in the Balkan states, in Turkey, South America, and from 1911 to 1913 in China. The firm also had a cartel tie with Mauser, the Germans' weapons manufacturer. In 1913, Greece ordered about 200,000 rifles from the cartel, and Romania ordered 230,000. In the first months of 1914, those firms delivered 200,000 rifles to Serbia. Those export orders, moreover, were for a different model of rifle from the one used by the Austro-Hungarian Empire. The changeover necessary at the beginning of the war accordingly took valuable time. It appears that there was no coordination between the empire's political directorate, which included military leaders, and the arms manufacturers. The former saw Serbia as a serious threat to the monarchy's interests. They saw Romania as an uncertain factor, one threatening to join the Entente. Yet the arms sales to those nations continued. In 1913, the Kreditanstalt was Austria-Hungary's leading financial institutions. It was invited by a foreign consortium to participate in a transaction to extend the capacity of Russia's two biggest munitions plants, the Nevsky and the Putilov works. Alexander Spitzmüller, a representative of the bank, was somewhat concerned about the possible implications and consulted with the Ministry of War. He was told there was no objection to the operation. The Minister of Foreign Affairs expressed the same view. Spitzmüller's account, written long after the 1913 discussion, reads, "Count Berchtold declared that our relations with the Russian Empire were entirely friendly and correct, and he saw and he saw from the standpoint of the foreign policy of the monarchy no basis for refusing a share in the transaction. Spitzmiller, however, felt the move was problematic and dropped things out to July 1914 when the discussions were terminated. Bernard Mitchell provides a detailed picture of the relationship between the banks and the government in Austria-Hungary. The dual monarchy, he points out, had avoided the wave of militarism that broke over Germany. Opposition to that course was found more than anywhere else from the major banks, la grande bourgeoisie bancaire. In the eyes of the financial bourgeoisie, the army consisted of a reserve domain of the aristocracy, a world totally foreign to the banking universe. Banks had ties with some arms manufacturers, with Skoda and Vicoviva, but it was those firms that maintained relationships with the military, not the banks. The bankers, Mitchell reports, were, quotes, profoundly pacifist, not hiding their hostility to every warlike enterprise. As for the government contracts, Mitchell writes, the bankers exercise no real influence on the aristocratic Ministry of Foreign Affairs. The diplomats lived in a totally different universe from the one in which they, the bankers, are rarely admitted. Another author, Metz, confirms those judgments and adds other supporting evidence. His summary conclusion is that the financial world's most prominent representatives were as good as debarred from influence on the nation's foreign affairs. These remained the province of the dynasty and a small, exclusive group of higher nobility. Rudolf Sieghardt, a prominent banker, had previously held an important position in the government. He was in charge of the office of the Council of Ministers. This was prior to his appointment as governor of the Kreditanstalt, the central state bank. But those ministerial connections yielded little information and influence. Sieghardt's view was that, quotes, hostilities could, indeed, must be avoided. His account reveals the striking disparity between this banker's mindset and that of the small, exclusive group of policymakers. A quotation, his quotation, to the last moment, I did not believe that war would happen. I could not imagine that Austria-Hungary, of all the great powers, that with the weakest periphery, with an exposed situation on several fronts, and with the magnetic attraction exercised by numerous nations beyond its borders on their co-nationals inside them, would plunge into so risky an adventure. I still do not believe the folly of the erstwhile rulers, at least of all, their childish faith that Austria-Hungary would be dealing solely with Serbia. A meeting took place, bankers and representatives of the government in the midst of the crisis. On the 23rd of July, the day of the ultimatum was delivered to Serbia, the Kreditanstalt, as the central state bank managers invited representatives of the major Vienna and Budapest banks for talks. Purpose of the meeting was to urge the bankers to do everything not to arouse any great anxiety. The major banks had suffered defeat in three struggles over foreign policy in the decade prior to the Great War. They lost out in Serbia and much of the Balkans as a result of the Pig War. The bankers' hostility, it should be added, was not directed against the Serbs, but rather against the dual monarchies, agrarians, especially the protectionist Hungarians, who were the principal beneficiaries of the trade war. Aerenthal's decision in October 1908 to annex Bosnia was a unilateral one made within diplomatic circles. The resulting crisis did considerable damage to the banks and their interests. the annexation, Michel declares, contradicted the most elementary interests of the banks, causing certain losses for the entire economy in exchange for uncertain profits in a marginal geographic area. The bankers in this instance did not set policy, but Michel reports appeared as petitioners. They requested confidential information needed to avoid a more serious financial crisis. The year 1914 seemed very promising for the Austrian bankers. Anticipating peace and general reconciliation, they were collaborating with French capital and German capital of the Reich in the Balkans. In the entanglement of interests there, Michel reports, banking capital ignored the political blocs. That truth, he added, had never been clearer than on the eve of the war. For the Austrian banks, 1914 was the year of reconciliation with French capital, with the Paris markets about to be opened to Austrian securities. On July 20th, the Austrian banker negotiated in Paris announced that Premier Viviani favored a financial rapprochement with Vienna and that the Austrian loan would be sold in French markets that autumn. Michel concludes that if the banks had had as their sole objective their interests and their profits, they had to declare themselves against war. The decision to intervene, Michel concludes, was taken by the military and the diplomatic circles and in the common council of ministers, which was staffed almost exclusively by the nobility. It was not the capitalists or the bankers who had to choose between peace and war, but the Austria of the aristocrats. His conclusion is elaborated at some length, detailing the aristocratic presence among the decision makers, all of this set in contrast to the inability of the bankers to intervene. None of them, Michel declares, appears to have been consulted, and no name of a banker, no mention of influence by the press or that of the Bourse appears in the official documents. Michel's conclusion reads, it was the Austria of the diplomats and the generals, not the Austria of bankers, who at this point in July of 1914 pulled Central Europe into war. Am I running out of time? Let me just say a few words about Germany, and then I'll maybe say a few words of summary. A prominent figure in the German case is Albert Ballin. Ballin is the president of the Hamburg America shipping line and the world's largest shipping company, which for obvious reasons would be central to any German Weltpolitik and would be and was very seriously affected by the war, with massive numbers of their troops, of their ships abroad, and the declaration of the war, they basically lost troops. They had to support sailors here and abroad and their families and so on. And Ballin and his associates had no serious contact with or influence with the decision makers, who made a decision which was essentially desperate for them. I can pass over Krupp and Stinnes. Their influence was also very limited. The same holds with Rathenau. Let me come back to summary comments about Ballin. Ballin's reaction to the war was one of shock. One biographer said it was a war he loathed. Ballin regretted the many things that he might have done differently. He felt he should have argued more strenuously against Tirpitz's naval plan, one that could only end in war. In 1915, commenting on naval and commercial realities, he declared that his ships did not need the protection of the German fleet. At that point, he recognized his contribution. He said, I should have emphatically argued against the catastrophe, should have argued that with the Kaiser, but I could never summon the courage to do so. We were all too weak toward the Kaiser. No one wished to disturb his childlike, happy optimism, which could shift at once into an almost helpless depression if anyone criticized one of his pet projects. Among these, the fleet was the greatest. Now we have the result of our lack of courage. The last days of the war, as you know, Germany faces a revolution. The revolution is centered in Hamburg, which is center of Balin's location. The revolutionaries break into his office, threaten him. He leaves, goes home. He takes a large quantity of sleeping pills. He died within a few hours. His friends are divided as to whether it was an accidental death, an ulcer aggravated by the pills, or a suicide. We'll have to pass over the British case. Let me just say a few words of conclusion. As basically the evidence reviewed, my chapter in these three cases indicates support for the liberal position. Big business opposed to the war. It does not support Lenin in any way whatsoever. It also rejects the notion of business dominance. In these three cases, is business not at all dominant, as they are hardly heard. The political elites made their decisions with impunity, without any serious repercussions from the leaders of big business. Put differently, the business leaders in these states were powerless. The dominant rationale of the business leaders differs considerably from that of both the dynasts and the party leaders. Putting profits ahead of national power or prestige, they seek steady economic growth, extending their activities wherever it appears to their advantage. Both war and rumors of war threaten their foreign activities, reducing profits, and in the extreme case, bringing about confiscation of holdings. Increasing expenditures in peacetime would only pose some threat to profits, and that someone had to pay those costs. The longstanding rejection of the liberal review, the depiction of that position as naive and as its optimism is somehow pathological, is seriously misleading. The Great War began with decisions taken by three old regime coteries. The leaders of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire conspired to defend against threats to their empire, while Russia's leaders reacted to defend against the threat to their interests. France's leaders, the party coterie, reacted because their nation was attacked. Britain leaders entered the war for what might be described as strategic concerns. Had Austria-Hungary's and Germany's business leaders had their way, the Great War would not have happened. If the two Kaisers, Franz Joseph and Wilhelm, had said, no, there will be no war, there would have been no war. But they, along with Tsar Nicholas, said yes, and the war followed. A long-approved critical reading, put that in quotation marks, critical reading of the war's origins assumes a merger of the political and economic elites, treating them as working together for mutual benefits. That position provided justification for a new orthodoxy, but that reading makes two unjustified assumptions, that a merger had occurred and that both parties, therefore, were responsible for the decision. The evidence reviewed here does not support that claim. Thank
you. I think we will take some questions.
Questions, preguntas, fragen, question.
Is that? I'm not sure if that was a, is that a question, sir? No, I don't think so. All right. Thank you very much.
Professor Hamilton, it sounds like the business and banking communities of Europe going into the war were pretty much on the same track as Norman Angel. Would that be fair to say that, that he was capturing their attitude in terms of international relationship, the connection, the disruption of business that would be caused?
Yes, that would be fair. I mean, they were in connection with that whole batch of liberals that I mentioned.
But then if it's a follow-up to that, though, and this isn't really your discussion for today, but as they became dependent perhaps on war contracts and the financing of the war and so forth, might the same elements that had been in opposition to going to war have been a voice for sustaining the war and therefore not have necessarily supported initiatives for any kind of negotiated peace settlement?
Sustaining would be another question, and that would involve a separate and independent bit of research. Research might, explore the question of their profitability as of 1914, prospects for the next year, and so on and so forth. It's the next bit of research for somebody.
Thank you very much. I wonder, the second of your two Henry Ford quotes, the one about the Jews, that one sounds much more in character with Henry Ford than the first one about capitalism, but I'm wondering if you also encountered other strains and taints of anti-Semitism in the analysis of the economic origins of the war, particularly with thinking of, in this country, Charles Lindbergh Sr. And his railing against the money trusts and trying to keep us out of the war for that reason.
No, I didn't pick up any of that. I think Lindbergh's influence would have come later, wouldn't it? I didn't run across any except the Henry Ford quotation.
We have a question back over here.
Professor, a few years ago I read a comment that Russia had just exceeded its exports of wheat, I believe, from what they were able to export, I think, in 1913. What that struck me was how on the verge of World War I we were becoming more international in their trade, and we had all these relationships. And I've been in the finance business for over 40 years, and I can't remember a period when people who invest money like to live with the uncertainty that war brings about. So that's just my comment. I think it's a myth that people want war contracts to make profits.
It is a myth, as far as I can tell. It would take a very special effort to counter the evidence that I've uncovered here, or picked up as somebody else provided that evidence. I think the striking thing about, what do I call it, this standard position, the reading of business influence, I would call it a case of groupthink. As a collective, a body took this position. They agree with each other, mutual support, and so on and so forth. That is not the same as evidence. As at one point I suggested the use of some terms, declared truth on the one hand versus researched truth or research findings on the other hand. I'd say we have a large quantity of declared truths which are still present in our literatures, and I think we ought to go at them in a very serious way. And if we don't have evidence, if we have simply a quotation from Henry Ford or anybody else, we have to ask ourselves, what is the influence? Did anybody pay attention to it? How many people followed it? If we're talking about a newspaper and its influence, you have to talk about how many readers, what portion of the readers, where were they? Going along with the previous discussion, we have this focus on Pulitzer and Hearst. A simple question that I raised, addressed in a previous book, is how much influence did they have on the other side of the Hudson? Did their influence reach Jersey City and Newark? Did it extend to Chillicothe, Ohio, to Chicago, to Coon Rapids, Iowa? There's a whole range of questions that could be raised. They might have republished our articles from Hearst, but the question is, what position did they take with respect to that war? There are studies which review the positions taken by scores of American newspapers, and it does not reflect the Hearst and Pulitzer influence.
Your next question is back in the back.
Professor, you make a very strong point that the different classes or elite systems, and particularly of royalty and the military classes in Europe, might not have had the same interests as, say, the middle class bankers and capitalists. But in United States, for argument's sake, we didn't really have that same class, a royalty class, and the differences in elites. Our elite was very often the moneyed people who had just made a lot of money. So one of the big arguments that people make about why we went into the war was that we had lent so much money to the Allies that the only way to repay the bankers who had lent so much money was for the America to get into the war. Isn't there perhaps a stronger case that there was more of an economic incentive for us than perhaps in some of the European cases for them to start the war?
If that were the case, one would have to show the evidence on it. Let's review the evidence. Where does that influence exerted? Who exerted the influence? I would object to some of your formulations of some other speakers there, talk about class. Class is an invention. That is a, another one of those groupthink things. As we agree that there's a middle class, define it. Let's see what's their extents, what are its boundary lines. One easy option is to be found in public opinion polls from the first time they appeared in any serious way in the 1930s and on, is differentiation everywhere. One important source of differentiation is religion. Catholics and Protestants go in different directions. The first study I worked on dealt with Elmira, New York. Upper and upper middle class Protestants voted 98% Republican. The equivalent Catholics voted 50% Republican. What use is the word class in this connection? I checked that out in other surveys, national surveys, and we got exactly the same thing. In my later studies, studies of Germany and support for Hitler, religion is a very powerful factor. I would say it is a more important factor than class, certainly more important than the unsupported and ultimately rejected claim about lower middle class tendencies and propensities. Again, a fiction supported by groupthink processes.
Your next question will be coming right here from the middle.
Thank you for your talk. In the post-war era, there were a lot of investigations in the U.S. Congress. I believe it was called the Nyes Committee, whatever, the Merchants of Death. What were the arguments that were used in those committee hearings? Was it just anecdotal stories? Did they have any kind of reasoned research that you've had, or what?
I don't know. I didn't pursue that, follow that through. I was exploring the sources as of 1914 and thereabouts, antecedents. That too would be a kind of a useful subsequent research task.
He just asked the same question that the other gentleman wanted to know. So, great question.
My grandfather he was just buried in 1914, and I think there was a thing. Of course, we weren't in a war yet until 17, but the farmers were, they really were pretty busy, and the shiploads of the wheat going over to France and everything that we did later on. He always told me, and I always thought it was kind of interesting, he says, the last best year for farmers was 1913. I know that during the World War, even before we got into it, we were supplying a lot of food to go over. But then it's kind of strange that my grandfather, there was a downturn right after the war, and he literally lost a farm in 1920. And that really was always on his mind, how many lost the farm in 1920 after World War I. So it would appear to me that even though we might have really had a lot of industry or, you know, sending the food over, sending the wheat, sending the grain, something, you know, didn't work out quite right. It wasn't like guns and butter. We really weren't getting ahead with it. I'm trying to figure out what the mystery was or what the situation was.
Again, there are further details of this whole process, war making, which I think are not adequately explored. One that you mentioned, what's a farm look like? What does life on a farm look like? My father, who served in the war in the Canadian Army, born and raised in a farm, and his brother's also in the farm. One consequence of the war was sons were lost at the farm as some key farm laborers essentially went off to other tasks. But that's only a fragment of the larger process. I think we need somebody to undertake a study of farmers' wartime impact on the farm and kind of take it from there. There's a whole series of questions which I think are not properly addressed. As we talk about the impact of the mass media, and in this connection, one appropriate question, which was touched on earlier, was the question of literacy. Figure 90% was given. We get various figures and, you know, it's creeping upward and so on and so forth. But one needs differentiation. The world isn't divided into simple categories, literate and illiterate. There are degrees of literacy. People of marginal literacy would have difficulty reading an advanced newspaper. The question is, you know, how much of that content would they pick off? Another factor which is regularly overlooked, we talk about the masses, the public, and so on and so forth. One fact which one can gain from statistical abstract is average work week. 60 hours work per week for the full-time gainfully employed. That's 6 10-hour days. Now we add on to that the time of commuting, getting to and from work, much of it walking. And we add on the consideration that much of that work is physically exhausting. Daddy is going to come home, who knows, sometime after 6 o'clock in the evening. We're going to have dinner. And that's one time when the family gets together. But Daddy is going to fall asleep, maybe reading the newspaper shortly thereafter, and he's going to go to bed early. Now, is that father or his wife or any of the children, are they going to be engaged in advocacy for war or advocacy for imperial outreach or anything of that sort? An alternative hypothesis ought to be considered. No, they wouldn't have time or interest in that kind of thing. Is that interest is something generated by a small collection of intellectuals who created the view that we're talking about.
Your next question is from the front corner.
Yes, sir. A former president once said, I believe it was John Adams that said that facts are a stubborn thing. And so based upon what you have talked about today, would you say that probably the dispute that or the perception that people have is mostly ideological?
Different groups proceed in different ways. Even if we take a categorical term like intellectuals, you know, intellectuals are very differentiated. You know, some of them handle natural sciences and so on and so forth. You know, there are some general orientations which are favored, and, you know, the progressive view essentially is built into the system and lasts for essentially 100 years or so, and is accepted despite, I would say, serious difficulties. How much of the rest of the American public pays attention to that, accepts it, and so on. One thing that comes up in studies of public opinion polling, and so on, you know, we tend to think in terms of categoricals, either Republicans or Democrats. There are some people who are unsure, some people who don't know, and they exist in large numbers, specifically with regard to political issues. We ought to recognize that and pay attention to it rather than declaring that they are all holding to position A or position B. Another way of putting that is, I would say, the easiest conclusion that one can possibly offer with respect to, what do we call it, possibilities, is a three-word sentence, and the three-word sentence is, I don't know. And if that is correct and accurate, that should be the beginning point of one's work.